Please see important safety information at the end of the video. Only your doctor can determine if this therapy is right for you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining You Deserve Relief from Chronic Pain, a webinar hosted by Medtronic. We're glad to have you with us tonight. We're going to kick things off with introductions of our guest speakers, who will then cover some key topics, such as understanding chronic pain, available treatment options, benefits and risks, and expectations. And while our guest speakers will give a good overview of Medtronic pain therapies, you may still have a few questions following the webinar. We want you to know that we do have a few resources available if you're interested in learning more, including a chance to talk with a registered nurse, speak with a patient who has received Medtronic pain therapy and can share their personal experience, or even connect with a local representative in your area. We'll touch on these resources again as we conclude tonight's webinar, and you'll also receive access to these resources in an email you'll receive following the webinar. I'd like to begin by introducing our two guest speakers, Dr. Tammy Dann and Dr. Chris Beuer. Dr. Dann practices at the Pain Evaluation and Management Center in Dayton, Ohio, and Dr. Beuer comes to us from St. Louis, Missouri, where he practices at Christian Hospital Pain Management Center. Thank you both for being here with us tonight. I'm going to hand it over to you first, Dr. Dann, to take us through an overview of chronic pain.
Hello, my name is Tammy Dann. As she said, I am coming to you from Dayton, Ohio. So we're just going to do a brief overview first about what exactly is chronic pain. When do you feel like you are crossing over from an acute or a subacute pain to chronic pain? Well, technically, the definition is chronic pain is anything that lasts more than 12 weeks. So it may be you had an injury, it may be a disease process, or just an ongoing condition. So there are lots of different aspects that can play into this pain. Stress, environmental effects, and other factors can contribute to the whole pain process. And then this chronic pain will continue even after the treatment stops. So think about if you were to go in and get a knee replacement done. The knee replacement looks great. Orthopedic surgeon says everything is looking good right now, but it still hurts. You're still having what they would consider to be chronic pain because they don't see anything else that they can do for you, but you know, you're still having the pain. So you have to look and see what can be done for that pain at that point. So we'll break down the different types of pain. So you have a chronic back and leg pain. So these are classically people who have had surgery. The pain starts in your low back, it will radiate into your leg, it may wrap around, it can go to both legs. So anything pretty much waist down is what we're talking about with this. You'll see there it has a couple different diagnoses. I'm sure people have heard of these, degenerative disc disease, failed back. You might have a disc herniation, epidural fibrosis, which classically occurs after you've already had a surgery, and then also arachnoiditis. So that middle column is complex regional pain syndrome. Now this is kind of the pain specialist specialty right here. So we are the people that diagnose this. And this is something that often affects something that's peripheral. So a hand, a foot, that's where we see it most commonly. It can be, you know, a knee or a hip or a shoulder though too. So that usually develops after there's a specific injury that happens. So one of the most common ones that we see are people will slip, fall, break their wrist. So that is oftentimes one of the most common areas that you'll see. You may or may not need to have surgery to fix it, but for some reason the bone heals, but the nerves have kind of, for lack of a better term, went haywire. So when those nerves start going haywire like that, that's when we start looking at this as a complex regional pain syndrome. So the older terms that people will call this are reflex sympathetic dystrophy, causalgia. Some people shorten it and call it CRIPS. So if you've ever heard any of those terms before, those are all this same umbrella. And then the cause of this isn't really known. We don't know why one person will get this and another person won't. The last column discusses neuropathies. So this is basically something where the nerves are just very irritated. So a lot of times you can get chronic pain because you've had nerve damage. The most common one that we probably see would be a diabetic neuropathy, that classic burning in people's feet. Some people though can get a neuropathy and not be diabetic. It may be because you've had a gastric bypass and you're not absorbing certain nutrients as well. Sometimes people that have a history of alcoholism can also have issues with their nerves not being quite right in their hands and in their feet. Chemotherapy is one of the most common ones that we see. And then there's also some other causes of it that are listed below that. So what options do we have to treat chronic pain? Well, most commonly when we get patients in our office, they've already been on some sort of medication. Their surgeon or their primary care physician, someone else has tried to give them a medication, or the patient's been taking an over-the-counter medication like ibuprofen or Tylenol. Oftentimes, people have also been sent to physical therapy. So that's something simple that you can do to help with these various types of pain. The ones that become a little bit more scarce by the time we've seen people are the psychological therapies. And what we mean by that are stuff like cognitive behavioral therapy, coping, biofeedback. If you've ever heard any of those terms, those are classically utilized for pain. You've also got alternative therapies. So we're talking the acupuncture, massage therapy, the cupping. There's all different types of alternative therapies that people can do and do quite well with. You've got your corrective surgery. So that is, I already had my back fusion. I've already had my knee replaced. You know, you've already had the surgery that fixed what was wrong, but there's still pain with it. Now, some people will have had some therapeutic nerve blocks, but that's classically kind of up our league that we're dealing with. So nerve blocks, the medical devices, which we're going to talk a little bit more about tonight, and then also neuroablations or radio frequency ablations. So there are lots of different avenues that you can treat the chronic pain. And I usually tell everybody, you're going to be treated the best if we combine these different therapies. It's very hard to treat chronic pain and only use medications or only use alternative therapies or only use physical therapy. You have to kind of take a little bit of all of them and combine them all to really hit all the aspects of the pain that you're dealing with. So what therapies are we going to talk about tonight? So we are going to go in depth on spinal cord stimulation and targeted drug delivery. So these are two avenues that you can take that will be a long-term treatment. So these aren't meant to just be effective for a couple months. This is something that we're looking at for long-term, years and years and years. This is not something that you go to when you have an acute pain. Classically, if the pain's only been going on for 6 weeks, this is not what we're gonna look at. So the cool thing about these are that you can try these out before you go ahead and get them permanently done. So you can't try out your total knee before you go and get it in permanently. This you can actually try first. So people really like these options because you can give it a try, see if you like it or not. If you don't like it, you don't have to get it, but you can at least say, well, I at least tried this and saw what I had to offer. So the very first one that we're going to go into is spinal cord stimulation. And I usually describe this to my patients and say, this is kind of the voodoo that we do. So I know other physicians that don't even fully understand what this is. So we're going to try to take this down to a level that hopefully patients can understand. And I think most patients really get the gist of this once we kind of explain it just a little bit. So you'll see in the picture here, the spinal cord stimulator, it disrupts these pain signals that travel between your spinal cord and your brain. So there has to be some way for this pain signal to get back to your brain to tell your brain, yes, this hurts. So if we disrupt that and we block it off before it even gets up to your brain, then that's the best way that we can kind of play with those different nerve signals and neuromodulate them. That's where that word comes from, so that you're not feeling that pain. And sometimes we can make it so that you feel a different sensation, like a vibration sensation or something that's more pleasant, but you don't necessarily have to do that. So you'll see in the picture that there is a little battery-like device. It almost looks like a pacemaker. So anybody that has a pacemaker, I would describe this to them as it's identical to a pacemaker, but it's pacing your pain signals instead. So that little pacemaker type battery that's off to the side will send these signals through those little tiny wires there. And those are basically like little pieces of spaghetti that are then communicating in that epidural space. So basically this picture right here is telling you we're disrupting that pain signal with the device that we have right here. So you do get to test drive this. So that's the best part about this device, is that you can say, well, you know, I'm going to do this trial and just see if it helps. And if it doesn't, well, we just take those little leads out and I'm done with it. I don't have to have surgery. I don't have to have a big incision. I don't have to have anything for this. So you get to decide how well it helps your pain. And I always tell everybody ahead of time, you know, this is your dating period. You're not getting married right off the bat. This isn't, you know, we're going to go ahead and decide right off the bat, I want this within the first 24 hours. I want everyone to think about it for a while. Now, before we can do that trial, a lot of insurance companies will say that you need to do a psychological evaluation. Now, I tell everybody that I'm not really going to send you to get this therapy if I don't think it's going to help you and I don't think you're a good candidate. So I haven't had anybody that I really think this is appropriate for that has not passed this psychological evaluation. It comes down to that the insurance company wants to make sure that you in fact understand what the device is, that you also understand that, you know, it's probably not going to take every single last ounce of pain away, that you're reasonable, that you, you know, have pain that's coming from a certified source, and that it, you understand that it can be treated. So during the trial too, then we talk to you quite a bit during this period. So I'm usually having my representative or my office call and talk to the patient on a daily basis to see how they're doing with it. And we'll kind of get into how this trial itself actually works. So you'll see those are the trial components that are off to your right-hand side. So the first little area says, you know, these are the temporary trial leads. So these are the pieces of spaghetti. That's what I tell everybody. They're like little pieces of spaghetti. And then that little box that's in the middle, that is what is taped to you during this. So you do have to have a little box taped to you. And then you have a little programmer that you can turn it up, turn it down, change your program. You can turn it off, turn it on, depending on what you're doing. As far as all this goes, it's all held in by tape at this point. So we do a fancy epidural and we put those little leads in. I tell anybody that has had a labor epidural, it's essentially the same process where we're going to put those leads in. We're going to tape them all over your back. You are going to have tons of tape. And if you have a hairy back, I apologize in advance every time, because you will not have a hairy back when we are all done with all the tape that we put on. So we do numb it up. If I have someone that is particularly very, very anxious about it, you know, I sometimes will give them a little bit of medicine to help them relax. All the different physicians do this differently. The fact of the matter is, though, we want everybody to be comfortable doing during this trial. We're going to do whatever we can to try to make you feel comfortable. As far as the stimulation goes, we kind of ask you, where are you feeling this? So, you know, sometimes we look at the x-ray and we say, oh, this looks like it'll be fabulous. They're going to love this. And then we test it and you go, I only feel it on the left. It happens. So it just tells us, okay, let's move them a little bit. If we do that before we tape everything down, then, you know, we have the option to give you the best coverage that we can. And usually what we're looking for is, you know, are we covering the areas where you have the worst pain at? I don't want perfection. I don't have to say, we're going to cover every last bit from, you know, your waist down. I just want to cover your painful areas. That's the main thing, because this is just a test. It's a trial. It doesn't need to be perfect. So we connect those little trial leads right there to that little white box in the middle, and then we secure it all down, and then you're good to go. You get to meet with the representative. They kind of tell you how to work this little programmer. What we usually tell people is that when you're using this, during that, you know, some people it's 3 days, some it's five, some it's seven. It kind of depends. Everybody's a little bit different. I've had patients come back at 3 days and tell me, I definitely want it. This is, you know, the best thing ever. Can I get it next week? And I say, well, we have to, you know, pump the brakes a little bit here. But I have other people that come back at 3 days and go, I'm not really sure. You know, I think I need to keep it a couple more days and see how it's working. That's completely fine. We can maybe tweak the settings a little bit, see if we can get things covered a little bit better. And then we check back in with you, you know, and see if you're liking it or not. By and large, most people do very well during this trial period. We have you go ahead and do, you know, your usual activities, except you have to remember, these are taped in. So, you know, if you're normally going swimming, you're not going to be going swimming with these taped to the outside of you. We also tell everybody you can't take a full-on shower during this period of time because, again, they're all taped on. If it's summertime or you live in some place that has high humidity, the one thing I always add is don't go outside and do a whole bunch of stuff out in the hot and humid because you're going to sweat a bunch and then all that tape is going to come off. So there are a couple of limitations. The other thing is, you know, you can't totally do big twisting, big bends, big lifting, things like that. And people do try to do it because they feel pretty good. So, you know, we just have to keep you in check. You also can't drive with it on because you're not used to that sensation that you're having. So we just don't want it to surprise you while you're driving. So that's the big thing. We always tell you to turn it off while you're driving. So as you can see at the bottom, then it does review that that takes about 30 to 90 minutes. It so varies for so many different people. It just depends on, you know, how fast we get it to the area where it needs to be. And if it has your coverage right off the bat, it can be very quick. Sometimes it's a little more difficult, but we usually get a good result in the end. And then you will keep that, like I said, anywhere from 3 to up to 10 days. So what happens after the trial? So let's say you come in and we do what we call a lead pull in the office, which is where we pull all that lead out and we take all that tape off, and everybody loves us when we take all that off of them and tell them you can go home and take a nice shower. So if you tell me, yes, that worked great, I could walk longer, I could do all these different things. So what we do then is, usually people are like, can I get it put in next week? Usually not, because we do have to get it approved from insurance. We have to send everything to them, make sure that everything is going to get covered by your insurance company. I usually tell people fastest it's going to get done is probably about 2 weeks. That would be the fastest if everything goes right through. And we want the little needle poke holes where we did your trial at, we want those to heal up some too. And then as far as the implant goes, it's pretty much the same thing as far as putting those little leads in. The problem is we do have to get those implanted. So usually, and people do all different kinds of things. Usually if we're just doing those little leads that go in like that, we make a small incision so that we can put a little anchor around them and then we tack them down. And then we have to put that battery on the inside. Now it's not that big white box that you saw, it's that little tiny battery that we saw in the very first picture, and we'll go over that a little bit more as well. And then that's usually done at a hospital or a surgery center. You can have the trial done in the physician's office, but you know, to do the permanent implant, you know, we do that at the hospital. So that way you can have a little bit more anesthesia. It's a little bit more sterile as far as the environment goes. And then after the implant, most people will follow up with you about 7 to 10 days and make sure everything's healing up, get you to be reprogrammed, because the program that you like on day one, once it starts to heal up, might not be the program that you like on, you know, day 30. So we always want you to have the option to make changes. And so what are the benefits of this? Like, why would we want to get this? So we've said, you know, okay, it might make my pain better, but what does that mean exactly? So, you know, if we make your pain better, usually your quality of life is going to be better. You're not going to be ruminating on this pain anymore. So is this going to be more effective than, you know, the surgeon said, you know, maybe I need an extra level of fusion. Well, if your main symptom is pain, you know, this is going to be more effective than doing repeat surgeries over and over and over again. Now, as far as, you know, being functional, so we found in multiple studies that people can actually do their activities of daily living much better. And what that means is that, you know, you can walk out to get the mail now. You can, you know, take the dog out maybe. You can go down those couple steps that you couldn't go down before. You know, we're not saying that you're going to go out and run a marathon or go square dancing if you didn't do that already, but, you know, you should be able to do your usual activities and do them much more comfortably. Now, as far as what areas of pain is this for? So the main areas are going to be extremities, which would be arms, legs, and then also your back. The best areas for it to work are definitely back and leg pain. And then, you know, it says on this slide that there's personalized pain management. This is very personalized. So you get your own set of programming. So no one else probably has the same programming that you will have. Everybody has their own set of programming. And then you get to control this too. So you get to turn it up, turn it down, turn it off, turn it on, change your program. You have lots of different options that you can do with this. And then, you know, we do have lots of clinical evidence, lots of studies that show that this is a very good process, and that in the long term, we will probably even be able to not only get you functionable, but hopefully get some of those medications that you've been taking to be reduced as well. And I will say, as an aside, I have a patient that he had a spinal cord stimulator put in, and he started walking a bunch. And he said, oh, I'm not needing to take my medicines as much, and I'm doing so much better. And then he tripped over his cat and fell when he was out walking around doing stuff and broke his ankle. So, I mean, we have patients, they do so good that, you know, they're doing all the stuff they weren't doing before. And then we open them up for other injuries sometimes, but his actually made it, he said, you know, this kind of helped me see like, this is a totally different pain. So if they have new pain, if you have a new pain that comes up, this is not going to cover that new pain. This is mainly going to cover your chronic pain. So I just wanted to be clear that, you know, you don't have to worry about, well, what if I, you know, break my foot or something and I don't know it. You will still know what's going on as far as new pain goes. Now, this is a picture of that battery that I was talking about, and they compare it to a quarter. Usually I tell patients this is about two of those big silver dollars that are taped together, essentially. This is the world's smallest implantable device, and it has a very fast battery recharge. So it can go from empty to full in about an hour. So it's very similar to these new lithium ion batteries that you have in all your devices now, like your iPhones and your Apple Watches and things like that. So as far as this particular battery goes too, it will automatically adjust based on your body position. And what that means is that sometimes when you're in certain positions, like if you want to lean back or go forward, it will change that stimulation just a little bit. So this kind of smooths out that process for you. The other really awesome thing that my patients like is that you can get MRIs with this device. There are lots of devices that are like this that you cannot get an MRI with. You don't have to worry about not being able to go get the MRI if you know you tweak your knee or your shoulder or something like that. As far as the warranty goes, it does have a 9-year warranty on it, and it covers that entire life of it. So, you know, you have to understand that the company is behind you and they really want this device to be successful and work for the long term for you. And then we've had some recent data that's come out, and this newer programming algorithm that we have is called DPM. And, you know, I don't need to get into all the nuances of this particular programming, but this newest programming, we're having 7 out of 10 patients reporting profound back pain relief. That's a big deal. Profound back pain relief is over 80%. So, you know, if you think about if I had 80% less back pain and that's your main pain, you know, that's making it so that you can actually be a lot more functionable and have a lot less pain. And then it just shows as well that the pain scores went down from a 7 to about a 2 for back pain, and from about a 6 to a 1.5 for the leg pain. So again, it covers both back and leg very, very well. And then what are some of the risks to this? So, you know, anytime you do any sort of surgery, you are going to have, you know, infections, bleeding. Anytime you do surgery, those are going to be risk inherent. Ones that are specific to spinal cord stimulators are that those little leads, sometimes they can move. So, you know, it's always a possibility. At some point in time, you might have something totally different going on, and the therapy might just not be covering that anymore. So sometimes you have a loss of therapy effect. Sometimes, you know, you're like, you know, my trial did really awesome, but this isn't quite working quite as well. Usually we will do everything in our power to get that to work, but every so often, you know, there might be someone that's expectation isn't fully met. And, you know, that's why we try to set expectations at the beginning of this. And, you know, try to let you know, like, you know, if we did the trial and you told me you got 40% benefit, I'm not going to promise you that the implant's going to give you 80%. You know, we can't make promises like that with the therapy. It either helps or it doesn't help. So with that, I will pass this off to Dr. Beuer, and he is going to talk a little bit about the targeted drug delivery.
Hi, everybody. I'm Chris Beuer. I'm a pain management physician in St. Louis. And thanks, Dr. Dann. That was a great overview of spinal cord stimulation, a pretty complex topic. So I have something I think a little bit easier for me to understand, at least. And what is really one of my favorite therapies out of everything we do that Dr. Dann mentioned, we have so many tools at our disposal, but for patients that just don't respond to the conservative treatment therapies and the medications and injections and so forth, we're left with what I think are by far the two best options, and that's spinal cord stimulation and targeted drug delivery. So targeted drug delivery, it's a fancy way of saying that we're just going to take medication and we're going to put it in a much more effective spot. So there's obviously a lot on the news right now about opioids and their role in pain and addiction and so forth. And, I don't want to go over all of those things in great detail, but suffice to say, for many of our chronic pain patients, the opioids, unfortunately, just have not been able to control their pain for a long period of time. And that's really one of the biggest issues when it comes to opioid management. They can work at first, but after a while, they lose their effectiveness. Or for many patients, they cause side effects, especially our older patients. The side effects are intolerable and they can't even get to a dose that provides a reasonable amount of relief. And what we're doing with targeted drug delivery is we're taking a fraction of that amount of medication and we're just putting it in a more effective spot. So people always wonder, if you fall down and you break your ankle, or if you've had back surgery years ago and your back still hurts and you're taking medication, how does that pill know where to go? And it doesn't. It goes throughout the body. Most of it gets destroyed by the liver or excreted by the kidneys and so forth, but it can also go throughout the body. And that's what leads to some of those side effect issues. With targeted drug delivery, we're taking a small amount of medication and we're putting it into the spinal fluid, and that's where our pain receptors are. So the amount of medication is somewhat similar. If you imagine just taking one pain pill and you smash it with a hammer, and then you take the tiniest little bit of that, that's the amount of medication that a pump will deliver over an entire day. So it's essentially a negligible amount of medication, which is why you don't typically have side effect issues, but it is so effective because of where it is administered that patients get fantastic pain relief. So this is administered through a device called a pump. You may have heard it referred to as an intrathecal pump or a pain pump, but it really is just that. It's a circular device that we can fill with medication, typically an opioid. There is a non-opioid option that can be utilized as well. And then we connect to that a very small tube. It's similar to what Dr. Dann said with the stimulator. It's kind of like a spaghetti noodle. It's a little smaller than that. And so we implant the pump under the skin, and then we connect the tubing and put that into the spinal fluid. And that's all the pump does. It just puts medication through the tubing into the spinal fluid right by those pain receptors. And I think at the bottom of the slide there, that's important. Most people experience fewer or more tolerable side effects. And again, in our older patients, that's one of the limiting factors for getting relief with oral medications. And with a pump, those issues are essentially gone. So this also requires a test. And I love Dr. Dann's reference that this is like dating before marriage. So you do get to take it for a test drive. And these are really the only two surgeries that I know of that you get to test out before you actually go ahead and have it done. And we certainly don't want to talk anybody into getting relief. We want this to be a very legitimate test and we want to make sure that it was worth it to the patient. And so, we'll typically ask, well, what percentage better did you get? And those numbers are important for us, but we mainly want to know, did you get enough relief that it was worth it to you to give you enough functional benefit that you want to go ahead and proceed with that implant? And as we've mentioned, zero pain relief is not the goal, and it's not reasonable for everyone. It does sometimes happen, but we want to make sure that the pain is substantially improved and that you're able to reach the goals that are important to you. And, I have some patients who are on the younger side and they want to be able to continue working and stay active and go to the gym and those things. And we have some older patients whose goal is to really maintain their independence and their quality of life and avoid going into assisted living or be comfortable in assisted living. And so it really depends where you fall on that spectrum as far as your goals. But targeted drug delivery is really one of the best options to get us there. I have I actually have a patient who I implanted her pump when she was in her 20s. She's about 30 right now, and she was a nurse anesthetist, and she couldn't work any longer, and she had the diagnosis of CRPS that Dr. Dann had mentioned from a prior surgery, and we put a pump in her, and she was able to go back to work, and she's actually she's almost running a marathon. She's at the half marathon level. So on the flip side, I have another gentleman who's 90 years old, and I don't tend to love to operate on a 90-year-old, as you can imagine. No one really gets excited just because of the age, but this is a pretty healthy 90-year-old, independent, still walked every day, and was starting to struggle with being able to stand long enough to make meals and do laundry, and was worried about needing more help. And ultimately, his pain was not controlled from a prior low back surgery. And we ended up doing the test for that gentleman and implanting a pump, and he's 93 now, and again, still doing well, but his goals are obviously different. But whatever the case, targeted drug delivery can certainly be one of the best therapies to help you reach those goals. So we do a test very similar to the spinal cord stimulation, but this test is a little bit different. It's a little bit easier, it's faster, but it doesn't last quite as long. So for most patients, this test lasts a day, and we'll go over that in just a minute here. But this is really a sample of what it would be like to have a pump implanted. And again, we're looking for some improvement in pain score, but also independence and activity and mobility and so forth. So how does this get tested? This may somewhat depend on the physician that you work with, also somewhat in the area that you live and insurance and so forth. There's two different ways. The older way, I would say, is putting in a temporary catheter, and that gets medication infused over a day or a few days. That's probably not utilized too frequently anymore. Most physicians will do what you see on the left of your screen there, which is a single injection. And I'm always hesitant to describe this to patients because it can be looked at as, well, I've already had injections before and I don't need another injection, and what's this going to do for me? And I always want to clarify that this is very, very different than anything else that we've done before. And this is not an injection to make your pain get better and last. This is the test. And so this test takes a minute or two, and it's a single injection of the pain medication that we plan to use in the pump. And we inject the medicine where it needs to go with a pretty small needle. And then you're on your way, and you go home and you try it out for the rest of the day and into the evening, and you see how you do. And it typically, again, doesn't last more than a day or so, but then we will see you back at some interval that your physician decides and make sure that it worked for you. So after you've had the test, you come back in and you have that discussion of, am I better? You decide it works, and then we discuss, you know, are you ready to have this implanted? And as it relates to implanting the pump, I really want to make sure that we clarify that these are also procedures that are reversible. We hope that you don't need your stimulator taken out or your pump taken out, but it's also unique, in addition to the fact that you get to do a test for it, and that you're the same person if we take the stimulator or the pump out. So, you know, if you have your gallbladder taken out, your gallbladder is gone. If you have surgery on your back and have rods and screws put in or part of the bone taken out, those changes are permanent. And so these are a superficial procedure where we don't cut any bone, we don't cut any muscle, and it's reversible. So that's why somebody like my 90-year-old patient that I mentioned is still a candidate for something like this, because it's less invasive, and certainly an easier recovery for patients. In fact, I'll tell most patients that, you know, you may be sore for a couple of days at the incision sites, but nothing like a big surgery. And you're pretty much back to feeling good within a few days, and then hopefully much better than you were with the stimulator or the pump. We'll restrict you from doing anything crazy for about 6 weeks or so. I did have one gentleman that felt so good, he thought he would go golfing and bowling 2 days after having his pump put in. So we don't recommend that. But once you've recovered and we want you to live your life and do the things that you want to do, I think Dr. Dann did a great job mentioning that when you do feel better, you're going to want to be more active and we want you to. But sometimes after having pain for such a long period of time, there's some deconditioning of the muscles and so forth. And so we want to work together and spend time on gradually getting you stronger in a way that's safe. And you can really build up that conditioning and endurance to get you where you want to be. So when I put pumps in, I send my patients home the same day. Some physicians may keep you overnight. I think that's a personal preference, but most people will send you home the same day. And then we'll see you back a week or so later. We'll look at your incisions and make sure that everything looks okay. And then we'll probably see you maybe 4 or 5 weeks after that for kind of a final post-operative check. At that point, if the dosing is good and you're happy and we're happy, we really don't need to see you that often. About every 3 to 4 months, most patients will come in and have their pump refilled. I have a few patients that come from hundreds of miles away and the trip can be difficult. And so there are occasionally options to have patients' pumps filled closer to their home if that's a concern for people, because this therapy isn't available in every small town, but there are many physicians across the country who offer it, and we want to make sure that everyone has access. So if you live a distance away from a provider, there's certainly ways that we can help with the follow-up component of that as well. But patients will come in, have their pump filled. I kind of look at this like a trip to the pharmacy to get medications. So you'll come in and the nurse will fill your pump or the provider will fill your pump, and it takes a couple of minutes to do. So we don't have a good picture of the pump, but later we'll get you some resources to follow up on some of the things we mentioned. But the pump has what is essentially a one-way valve in the middle of it. And so that's how it gets filled. So it gets filled through the skin, through a small needle, and we'll just infuse some medication back into the pump. And it can be programmed wirelessly. So we can tell the pump how we want it to deliver the medication. We can have you get medication all the time. We can have it peaks and valleys depending on your day and so forth. So it's a really flexible therapy. But all of that can be done with wireless programming as well. So one of the cool features that we have is something that's called MyPTM. And there's a similar component with spinal cord stimulation where you have the opportunity to adjust the settings to your liking. Not everyone's pump comes with a PTM initially. It's kind of up to the physician how they think it is best for your pump to be programmed. But this is one of the options. And so this is a little tablet device like an iPod Touch, or this is Samsung's version. So it's a handheld, like a little cell phone. And so we know that patients, when they are more active, or if you have a big day coming up, you may have a little bit of a spike in pain. And this allows you the flexibility to self-administer an increased boost of medication. So we control that to some degree, how often that's available and the dose and so forth. But this is a great option for people that have situational pain. So the person who, you know, a few days a week is going to the gym, and maybe as they're working on getting stronger, their pain gets a little bit worse and they can give themselves a little bit of an increase. Or I have some patients that still are working a job that's a little bit heavier on the labor side. And, you know, for Monday through Friday, they need that extra little boost and they can do it with this. So whatever your situation, this could be a really nice option, but you don't have to have this either. Again, there's a lot of flexibility in the programming that we can do, and we can tell the pump to give you a big dose before you wake up in the morning, if that's your most painful time, or before you go to bed, or in the afternoon. So communicating with the physician your needs and where you're at with the pump is really important, so that we can make sure that we fine tune this for you and make it the best therapy that it can be. So if we look at the benefits of targeted drug delivery, again, number one on everyone's list is making your pain better, right? And that's the key to helping you sleep better and helping you to be more active and so forth. So by far, that is our number one goal, is to improve your pain. And as I said, you know, realistically, pain at zero is not going to happen for most patients, but substantially improved. And as Dr. Dann showed you with spinal cord stimulation, we have many studies that show the decrease in pain scores with those devices in patients, you know, just like you with similar conditions. And with targeted drug delivery and pain pumps, we again have a lot of research that shows how effective this is. It's always hard when you're doing something over the computer like this to convey how much I think this means to us. And in my own practice, I have almost 350 patients that have pain pumps. And these are some of the most rewarding patients that I've been able to take care of, because they've been told by other physicians that, you know, they can't be helped or there's nothing left to do. And you know, that impacts every component of life, right? When pain limits what you can do, how you can sleep, your interactions with other people. So this is life-changing for so many people. And I'm so thankful that I have the opportunity to help patients with this. I love it. And it's incredibly rewarding. And that's where this quality of life aspect comes in. And so being able to manage pain and lower it to a level that's tolerable, that patients can be active with, is our goal. And one of the stats that I love on this slide is that 90% of patients would recommend this therapy to a family or friend. And that really speaks volumes to the effectiveness of targeted drug delivery. The side benefit here is that for most patients, we're able to get rid of oral pain medications, typically able to get rid of a lot of medications that sometimes get thrown at patients with pain, because sometimes we don't want to give out opioids, right? Again, with all the restrictions, you get thrown a handful of other medications and, you know, people hope it works and you somehow end up on it 5 years later and you're on a bunch of medications. And so being able to come off of those medications is absolutely a side benefit that we can get. And we don't tend to recognize the long-term side effects of oral opioids. You know, we think about drowsiness and constipation and addiction and tolerance and some of those issues. So some of those things are under-recognized. So being able to get rid of the oral opioids is certainly a great benefit as well, but primarily we're trying to get you that excellent pain relief. So it's never fun to have to say how much I love targeted drug delivery and then go over the risks of this. But right, there's risks with anything that we do. I think it sounds a little bit scarier than both of these things really are. And again, we have great data that shows how safe both spinal cord stimulation and targeted drug delivery are. And when it comes to targeted drug delivery, if you look at the safety, again, remember that we are taking a microscopic amount of medication and giving it into the spinal fluid space. So far safer than any pill. The main risks though, primarily revolve around any surgery, right? So anytime you pierce the skin, there's a risk of things like bleeding and infection and so forth. Those risks are exceedingly low. And obviously we take every care possible to avoid those. And fortunately, as I mentioned earlier, it's a superficial surgery. So we're not getting down into the deeper structures, which I think limits that risk. So if we look at targeted drug delivery as a whole, I think, you know, where I just want to kind of end this for you with targeted drug delivery is, I feel like for a lot of patients, you've been promised things over the years that the next surgery was going to be the answer, or the next pill or the next injection. And unfortunately, pain management physicians as a whole, we don't do a great job as a group. And I think there's a lot of variability in the providers that are out there and what they may offer you. And so my advice is, if you're not comfortable, don't stop right now, because many patients haven't heard of spinal cord stimulation. Many providers haven't heard of or are not familiar with spinal cord stimulation or targeted drug delivery. And I want you to keep going and try and get to someone who's there to help you. And so we're at my office, we're very happy to be the last stop for people. We want to be their last stop. And so we want to be the office that finally gets things right for them. And so if you're struggling, keep looking. And I encourage you very strongly to give spinal cord stimulation and or targeted drug delivery a try. And that's the benefit of doing the test, and see if it works for you. And honestly, I'm very confident that it will. Again, not 100% pain relief, but substantially better pain and improved quality of life. So as I mentioned, not everyone is trained to be able to do these things or is aware of kind of the updates. I think it's interesting that spinal cord stimulation and targeted drug delivery have been around for a long, long time, kind of like cell phones now. But similar to cell phones, there's updates and new things every year and all the time. And especially over the last few years, there has been an immense improvement in both therapies. And so if you're somebody who's actually even heard of these or tried these in the past, consider it again, because we've learned so much more to the point where, again, I'm very confident that we can get almost everybody comfortable and improved with one of these two devices. And so you've got a few options from here for where to go. So there are Medtronic representatives that are glad to speak with you about this. You can talk with one of the nurses involved. And both of those options, you know, can set you up with a provider that is trained and experienced in both of these therapies. And I think one of the neatest things that Medtronic can offer you as well is to speak with a patient, someone who has had chronic pain and who's probably been through similar things that you have been through, and get their experiences on these things. And, you know, we try and be as honest and forthcoming as we can, but I know it's a little bit different hearing it from a provider as opposed to patients who have gone through what you've gone through. So look into these options if you're struggling in any way. And I know there are many people out there who are very willing to help you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Beuer, and thank you, Dr. Dann, for sharing your expertise with us tonight. That concludes our webinar tonight. Please watch your email for more information on how you can learn more. And feel free to always reach out to us at medtronic.com/chronicpain. Thanks again for joining us tonight.